World Affairs Council of Greater Reading is the leading educational organization promoting understanding and enlightenment on global issues. Welcome back. I am once again your host, Mike Sutton. You will likely notice that I am not in the studio this evening. In fact, I am recording in advance from my home studio. And we're going to have a little bit different format tonight. At the end of each show, I promote some of the upcoming events that we have at the World Affairs Council. Today, I'm going to share one of those events with you. Last month, I mentioned that we had Bayan, Sami, Abdul, Rahman coming to give a presentation called Kurdistan, an Island of Security in a Turbulent Middle East. And this evening, I'm going to share part of that presentation with you. Overall, I think it was 45 minutes or so with a Q&A at the end. I'm going to share with you the first 20 to 25 minutes, and I hope you enjoy it. Without further ado, here's Bayan.
So I'm going to start with three maps. The reason we need maps is because there isn't a nation state called Kurdistan. We are a people who live across four countries, Iran, Iraq, Turkey, and Syria. So hopefully you can see on that map where those four countries meet is where Kurdistan is. And the number of Kurds across those four countries is very hard to say accurately. Those who want to minimize the number of Kurds will say, oh, 20 million. Nationalist Kurds will say 50 million. So it's very difficult to know because really the governments of those countries, so that's Ankara, Tehran, Damascus, Baghdad, or Baghdad in the old days, usually want to minimize the number of Kurds in their country. And so we estimate that in Iraq there are 6 or 7 million Kurds, and that's where I'm from. In Iran, 10 or 12 million Kurds. In Syria, 2, maybe 3 million Kurds. In Turkey, 15 million, 20 million, 25 million. We don't know. Istanbul has a very large Kurdish population, maybe 2 million Kurds in Istanbul. If that's accurate, that makes Istanbul the largest Kurdish city in the world. So now we're looking at Iraq, and the area in orange is the officially recognized Kurdistan region. I'll show you another map that will show you the areas that are disputed. We recognize them as Kurdish, but Baghdad does not, and so they have a special designation. But this corner of Iraq, known as Kurdistan region, is recognized in the Iraqi constitution as a region within Iraq. And Kurdistan region has a parliament, a president, prime minister, and cabinet, and representatives abroad, the equivalent of embassies. And of course, we have one in Washington, D.C., and I'm the representative, and my colleague Alex Ebsery, is the director for public affairs. So, Kurdistan region has a population of about 5 million, and it's really quite similar to Scotland in the United Kingdom. Scotland also has a population of about 5 million, also rich in oil, also has disputed territories with England, and we're mountain people, just like the Scots. And actually, we also like whiskey, like the Scots. They make it, we buy it. It's the formula. So this is the map to show you. Kurdistan region is the green area, and then the other colored areas are what are called disputed territories. So I'm just going to explain briefly what this dispute is about, because it's even today it's very explosive and very important, not just for Iraq, but also for the international community. So those areas include the city of Kirkuk. Kirkuk is the red square in the yellow area. I don't know how well you can see that. Kirkuk sits on top of massive oil fields. Historically, geographically, linguistically, culturally, it has been Kurdish. Of course, other communities have lived there too. it's not purely Kurdish, and we never say that. There are Turkmen, there are Arabs, there are Assyrians and others who live in that area. But overall, it has been a Kurdish area. And if you look at the Ottoman maps of 200 or 300 years ago, you will see an area that was called Kurdistan, and Kirkuk is in the middle of it, or in the heart of it. So Kirkuk, because of the discovery of oil by the British about 100 years ago, or maybe more, became a disputed territory. And over time, various governments in Baghdad gerrymandered the borders so that the provinces became less Kurdish populated. They forced populations out of their homes, a forced expulsion of Kurdish communities. And this program was actually given a name by the Iraqi government at the time, the former regime. It was called Arabization. So they were very public about it. It wasn't that they hid their agenda of forcefully changing the population so that it was, there were fewer Kurds in those areas. Another area I would like to point out, it's the yellow corner on the top near to Syria. And there's a city there, or a town there, called Sinjar. I'll come to Sinjar later, but please remember that name. It's actually my hometown. And the fact that it's very close to Syria is very important. So Kurdistan region is majority Kurdish and Muslim, and we are Sunni Muslim by majority. But we are a very diverse population, and this picture shows a picture of a Yazidi about to enter the main Yazidi temple in the world, actually, but it's in Iraqi Kurdistan, called Lalish. So we have Yazidis, we have Christians, we have other minorities, Shabak, Kakei, Sabian, Mandaeans, and others. And ethnically, there are vast majority are Kurdish, but also Assyrian, Turkmen, some Arabs in places like Kirkuk and the periphery. There are also, as I said, Christians. I think Iraq was one of the first countries in the world to adopt Christianity, maybe in the first century AD. A little bit about our history. So after the First World War, the Sykes-Picot Agreement came into place. This was an agreement between essentially France and Britain that was then adopted by the international community after the First World War. The Sykes-Picot Agreement really redrew the map of the Middle East. It was the end of the war. The Ottoman Empire was going to be broken up, and the state of Turkey was created out of the remnants of the Ottoman Empire. The people of Kurdistan were not really consulted, and we were divided along the borders that exist today. And that's why we ended up with populations in Iran, Turkey, Iraq, and Syria. The history is a little bit more complicated than that, but I'm summarizing, and I'm happy to go into more detail later. Our history in those countries was not a happy one. Each of those countries turned into an authoritarian state in one shape or another. And in Iraq, we ended up with a brutal dictatorship from the 1960s onwards until the liberation of Iraq in 2003. And so our history in Iraq, the Kurdish history in Iraq, has been very bleak, has been full of tragedy, trauma, cruelty and violence. The Kurds have been the victims of repeated acts of genocide, and particularly under Saddam Hussein. Earlier I talked about the Arabization program, the forced displacement of people, and my own family was my extended family was a victim of that in Sinjar. My grandmother has told me the story of how one day the authorities showed up and told her she had to leave her home with her children. And so they were out in the street with nothing. They knocked on the doors of their neighbors, and their neighbors said, "We're not allowed to take you in." The authorities told us, "If we take you in, we also will be thrown out." So the only thing the neighbors could do was to give them some blankets and water. And so they slept on the street. So imagine that. Imagine someone walking into your home tomorrow lunchtime and forcing you to leave your home, and that's it. You never return to that home again. You can never go back to your job. You lose your property. Any other businesses, land, farms that you own are gone. That has happened to the Kurds in Iraq repeatedly. And of course, Saddam Hussein used chemical weapons. Many of you may have heard about Halabja. In 1988, chemical bombs and conventional bombs were dropped on a city with a population of about 70,000. 5,000 men, women, and children were killed, and about 10,000 fled mostly to Iran for refuge because Halabja is very close to the Iranian border. Even today, 30 years later, 31 years later, the victims, the survivors of that chemical attack live with respiratory health problems, cancers, deformed children, and so on, in a very unhappy situation. And there is a court case that's begun in Paris to sue some of the European companies that provided chemicals to Saddam Hussein for his program of destruction and death. So our history in Iraq was not a happy one. We lived under a genocidal dictator. He created a war against Iran. About 1 million people on both sides died in the Iran-Iraq war. He invaded Kuwait, which was a colossal mistake, as well as a human tragedy. And the mistake was he didn't expect that the international community, and particularly the United States, would react. But of course they did, and that saved us as well. So what happened was that the United States and the coalition liberated Kuwait, and the people of Kurdistan and Iraq were encouraged by George H.W. Bush to rise up against Saddam. They did, we did. Unfortunately, when the uprising happened, Saddam Hussein was allowed to use his helicopter gunships and his military to crush the uprising. And don't forget, this was early 1991, only 3 years after Halabja, 5,000 people had been killed in a chemical attack. When the international community didn't stop Saddam's attack against our people, we all thought he's going to use chemical weapons. And so about 2 million Kurds fled Iraqi Kurdistan to the mountains on the border of Iran and Turkey. Imagine that, the biblical scale of that mass exodus as people ran for their lives and to save their children. And many people died of exposure. This happened in winter, spring of 91. It was an incredibly long and bitterly cold winter, much colder than usual. And many people died on the journey or on the mountaintops from starvation and exposure. And my grandfather was among those who died on that journey. But then the United States, Britain, and a few other countries did step up and decided to act. And so the safe haven was created in Kurdistan and a no-fly zone. And Operation Provide Comfort was established. Operation Provide Comfort was at that time a unique military humanitarian operation on a bigger scale than anything that had been done before. And we're very thankful to the United States, Britain, and other allies who implemented Operation Provide Comfort. We remember what happened. I wasn't there, as you can probably tell from my accent, I was living in the UK. But we were glued to our TV screens. We were trying to contact relatives, but there was no way of communicating at that time. And we didn't know if they lived or died. And so when Operation Provide Comfort was launched and people were saved and rescued, and there was a very clear message to Saddam Hussein that he has to withdraw from the Kurdish areas and that he has no right to attack the Kurds any longer. This was a turning point in our history. Up to that point, we had been a neglected part of Iraq, at best neglected. At worst, we were suffering genocide, the chemical bombardment of Halabja, the disappearance of 8,000 men and boys from the Barzani clan, the disappearance of thousands of Feili Kurds, that's another minority within the Kurdish community, and the Anfal campaign. The Anfal campaign was a deliberately designed genocide campaign. It was a plan that had geography, that was done on an industrial scale. And in that campaign, nearly 200,000 people were killed or disappeared. And even today, we find mass graves, particularly in southern Iraq. Many of those people were sent to the south and then killed, and they're buried in the deserts on the border with Saudi Arabia. So the liberation in 1990, sorry, the Operation Provide Comfort, the no-fly zone that was established over Kurdistan after 1991 was a huge turning point for us, because it meant that for the first time we were free of the grip of Saddam Hussein, of the dictatorship. So what did we do? A year later, 1992, we had elections. The first time there were free and fair elections anywhere in Iraq, and certainly in Kurdistan. As a result of those elections, we created the Kurdistan Parliament, which began to pass laws, still does to this day. We established the institution of the president, the prime minister, the speaker of parliament. We passed a law establishing the Peshmerga as the legal military of the Kurdistan region. And then other institutions were established, like the representations abroad, that were also established in the 1990s. So all of this done was on a tiny scale. There was no money in Kurdistan at that time. Kurdistan had been economically totally devastated. Saddam Hussein, besides the killing of people on an industrial scale, had also destroyed 4,500 villages in Kurdistan. So only 500 villages were left. This destroyed our way of life up to that point. Up to this was, like, I'd say 70s, 80s. Up to that point, we had been a very rural society. He destroyed that. It also destroyed our main industry, which was farming and agriculture. So there was no economy to speak of. But still, we wanted to establish a form of democracy in Kurdistan. So the 1990s went on like that. Unfortunately, we fell into a terrible civil war internally in Kurdistan in the 90s. By the late 90s, there was a ceasefire brokered by Washington and others. And there was the beginnings of a peace and stability around, let's say, the year 2000, 2001, and 2. And then, of course, 9/11 happened, and soon after that, it became clear that the United States would invade Iraq and liberate us from Saddam. Really, the period after 2003 opened a golden decade for us. I've described the economic neglect and then later destruction, the genocide, the cruelty and violence, the lack of a voice internationally or domestically that we had. 2003, the liberation changed all of that. We were very optimistic that with the liberation, Iraq would become a new country, a different country. It would be democratic, it would be federal, it would be pluralistic and accept the diversity. We're not all Muslim, we're not all Arab, we're not all Kurd, and that Iraq would accept the diversity of the country and give everybody equal citizenship. And we put all of our effort into making Iraq a new federal democratic country. We took senior positions in the government, in the federal government in Baghdad. Kurdistan region was recognized in the new constitution of Iraq, which was established in 2005. And economically, from 2003 to about 2013-14, Kurdistan flourished. There was a flourishing of construction, retail boom, travel. Don't forget, under a dictatorship, you can't travel. Suddenly, education. We could teach our children things that they either didn't know about because the internet was banned, we were not allowed to use certain textbooks, and English became the second language. Everybody in Kurdistan wants to learn English. So this was really a golden decade, and we were able to do much more on the international stage. We were able to have a voice internationally. Because of our leadership role in Baghdad, the international community, when they dealt with the Iraqi government in Baghdad, they were also dealing with Kurds, like President Talabani, like Hoshi Azebari, who was Iraq's foreign minister and later finance minister. And today, the president of Iraq is again Kurdish, Berham Saleh. The deputy prime minister for economic affairs is Kurdish, Dr. Fuad Hussein, and there are other Kurdish high-level officials in Baghdad, as well as members of parliament. So we enjoyed this golden decade, and we were very optimistic. Politically, things were not going so well between Erbil and Baghdad, but otherwise, this was really a time for a flourishing of Kurdistan. And then suddenly in 2014, ISIS attacked. ISIS stands for Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, or Sham, or Daesh, as we call them in the Middle East. ISIS was an offshoot of Al-Qaeda. It's an Islamist, extremist, terrorist organization. Most of their victims actually are Muslims, but of course they are a threat to the international community. Some of the attacks in the United States were inspired by ISIS in the UK, France, Belgium, you know all, about all of those. So even though they were in Iraq and Syria, and they remain there today, they are a global threat. They're not just a threat to us. And so when ISIS in June 2014 overran Mosul, it was a shock to all of us in Iraq and a shock to the international community. Mosul is Iraq's second largest city after Baghdad. Historically, it's one of the big centers of the Middle East in terms of culture, intellectual debate, trade, and as a center of commerce within even the Ottoman Empire. So it was a shock that a small, at that time, a tiny organization could overrun the city of Mosul. And the reason that happened is because we started, as I said, after 2003, being extremely optimistic about this new Iraq, that, for example, the Iraqi army would not be used to terrorize Iraq's own population, that the Iraqi army would be made up of or would be a reflection of the diversity of the Iraqi population. There would be Kurds, Christians, Yazidis, Arabs, everybody, Shia, Sunni, would all be in the Iraqi security forces. But actually what happened, it started like that after 2003. The first few divisions of the new Iraqi army after the 2003 era were Kurdish. But over time, unfortunately, with certain leadership in Baghdad, a very sectarian agenda in Baghdad, the Iraqi army increasingly became an Arab Shia army. Mosul is a Sunni, Christian, Kurdish city. You have a Shia army defending a city like that. And the army had been hollowed out for political reasons. Buying a command position was the way you got that position. It wasn't through merit, it wasn't through rising through the ranks of the military. You could buy a position in the army. And so this wasn't really a true army that would defend its own people. So when ISIS, really in very small numbers, 1,000, 1,500, attacks a city of 2 million people with maybe 30,000 Iraqi military there, The Iraqi military did nothing. They took off their uniforms, they left their sophisticated American weaponry behind and fled. So ISIS took those Humvees and American tanks and other weapons, even helicopters, and used those weapons to terrorize other communities and cities and towns in Iraq, including the Christians and Yazidis who live in Sinjar and Nineveh Plain, which are very near Mosul.
All right, I hope you enjoyed that presentation as much as we did at the luncheon. If you did, you want to see the rest of it, there's about 20 to 25 more minutes that you can find on our website, wacreading.org. Just look for past events, or you can head over to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/wacreading, W-A-C Reading. All right, now it's time to talk about upcoming events. Thursday, October 10th, we've got Lawrence Cohen, who's going to be talking about the crisis in U.S. immigration policy heading along the U.S.-Mexican border. Mr. Cohen's a retired diplomat with the U.S. Department of State, and he'll describe the U.S. immigration policy and help us to examine the roots of the crisis on our southern border, as well as hopefully answer some questions about the current unsustainable situation. And we've got Terry Madonna, who is the Professor of Public Affairs and Director of the Center for Politics and Public Affairs at Franklin and Marshall College. On Wednesday, October 16th, we'll have our breakfast meeting, which we do at the Wyomissing Restaurant and Bakery, and he'll give a presentation called The Politics of Division. And I am going to mention once again, it is fast approaching. This is the last opportunity I'll have to tell you about it. Our Pub Global Trivia Challenge, which is coming up on October 17th. We're still looking for teams, as well as cheerleaders and people just looking for a fun night out. So check your calendars and head over to our website to register for this fun event. We'll be kicking it into high gear at around 5:30 p.m. on Thursday, October 17th. This is, of course, all in support of our program, the scholarship program in honor of Alan Miller, for the benefit of Berks County High School seniors who plan to major in international studies, political science, public administration, or other related global studies. Hope you enjoyed this show this evening. I will take one more opportunity to remind you that if you like the presentation today, want to check out some of our other programming, maybe attend a couple events, you can head over to wacreading.org/join to find out what we're all about, figure out how to get involved, learn how to attend more of these events for yourself. In the meantime, I'll see you back here again next month. Hope you enjoyed the show. See you again soon.